Them bones, them drives. Now hear the word of the Lord. I just need 20 minutes. Ezekiel saw them bones as he peered out into this vision. God holds this dreadful picture depicting post-exilic Israel to reveal how God identified and empathized with his people's feelings. But I'm so glad God didn't stop there. We hear God asking Ezekiel, "Son of man, can these bones live? Bones scattered and tattered. Bones that are very, very many and very, very dry." This question, "Can these bones live?" echoes our search for hope when you consider the valley of dry, dead stuff in your life. You must face this divine inquiry. Can these bones live? When you lay your head on your pillow and anguish over the stuff that keeps you up at night, your dry bones become very clear. And I'm a living testimony that sometimes people of faith face failure, adversity, poverty, and brokenness. Stuff that just doesn't work. About 3 weeks ago, I went to a chiropractor. He said, "Peter, you are 2 to 4 inches shorter than your ideal height. You only stand 6'4", but you should be 6'6" to 6'8" for your frame and size. But you had severe whiplash during your childhood, and so you have a reversed cervical curvature in your neck and vertebrae subluxation in your lower back and major disc degeneration all up and down your spine, and your body flexes in constant fight or flight mode just trying to compensate for your spinal misalignment." And I had just one question for him. Can these bones of mine live? Do I have any hope? He said, "Yes, good news, my friend. We can fix it all." He said, "When I'm finished with you, you'll be at least an inch taller." And I said, "Thank you, Jesus. There is hope for my messed up bones." All my life, I've felt God's healing power for my dry bone situation. At life's school of hard knocks, I've felt God's grace for all my issues. You know, years ago, I lived in such a messed up situation and condition that one elderly gentleman said to me, "Young man, go to college, seek for knowledge, stay there till you're through. If they can make penicillin out of moldy cheese, they'll sure make something out of you." And so I started out as an education major, then I switched to a religion major, then I did all the coursework for a master's in software engineering, and then I spent 6.5 years as a real estate investor up in Canada. But God waited till all my prideful ambitions dried up and died. Then God put his word in my heart and breathed new life into me. I know many of you can tell this story of how God brought you through your own valley of death and dry bones to restore your life. But I stand to speak for somebody today who has not yet experienced and encountered this kind of victory. Somebody may be feeling your private pain in a valley of dry bones right now. And so I just came by to speak a word for you today. Like Ezekiel, you peek through your window of your life at your own personal pain, your own personal valley of very, very dry, dead bones. And God's inquiry echoes up and down the corridors of your soul. Can these bones live? For somebody here always struggling to make ends meet, forever dealing with one month at the end of the money. Here's God's question, can these financial bones live? Or somebody struggling in your physical health, you tried everything, but you still suffer chronic pain, and now you feel like all you've got is a pile of medical bills on one side and the dry, dead bones of bad health on the other side. Just hear God's question to you, can these bones live? For somebody here looking out at the dry bones of a broken relationship, your marriage died on the rocks and love's sweetness dried up. somebody told you, told me just this past week actually, that my marriage feels like a three-ring circus. First I had the engagement ring, then I had the wedding ring, and now I've got the supper ring. I've got nothing left but a dry, dead relationship with no hope. Here, God's question, can these bones live? Or some single person living with the pain of many attempts at love. Maybe you watched Prince Harry and Meghan Markle wed last night. And that spark of Markle has you wondering, when will my love come at last? Like Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz, you've been going on life's yellow brick road. You dated the Scarecrow, but you found out he had no brain. And then you dated the Tin Man, but you learned he just didn't have the heart for relationship. Then you tried on the Lion, but bless your soul, he didn't have the courage for the relationship. Just hear God's question to you, can these bones live? Or for this community of faith, feeling like we just died and dried up. Well, I hear you saying we used to have a full, joyful, exuberant church. I've heard so many of you speak of the good old days of yesterday, the times when you couldn't get parking unless you came early to church, and every pew filled up before the divine hour worship service started. I've heard you talk about the glory of your historical legacy. I've heard many reminisce about the wonderful days of yesterday when the church seemed to thrive and bustle with spiritual joy. Now that attendance declined and membership dropped, and maybe the giving seems down a bit, you wonder, can these bones live? Maybe you feel like this has become a Vallejo of dry bones. I just stopped by to tell you, fear not, my brothers and my sisters. There is hope for you this day. God asks Ezekiel, and all of us, this question, can these bones live? Clearly the bones can die and rot and stink, but can they live? Can they experience revival, renewal, resurrection, and new life? And I wonder, why must God take Ezekiel to Death Valley for this quickly? God raises this question of hope in the very pit of hopelessness. Ezekiel was in the very pit of hopelessness. He watched his entire comrades and friends sit destitute, destroyed, and decimated in a dark, dismal exile. And so this dreary movie tells us certain joys can be only felt through tears, and some heavenly stars only shine visibly at night. And the restoring hope God offers shows our most in desperate despair, because resurrection can only come sometimes through emptiness and death. And so I read this story in that context because I discovered in my own life that when my bones seemed driest, that my hopes felt strongest, my songs clearest, my faith dearest, and my God nearest. So the vision of the valley of dry bones carries a message of hope that God injects into Ezekiel's nightmare concerning his defeated nation. And the point of the message says simply, if God can make dry bones live, then God will make a way for you this day. And that's all I came to say to you today. God will carry you through whatever you may face. But often before God delivers breakthrough for you, God will put some question on your mind to force you to search your soul. God asks no questions seeking answers and information, for God understands all dimensions and God knows all things. God always questions to see where you stand in your hope and faith. God asks Adam, where are you? God asks Job, where were you? God asks Cain, where's your brother? God asks to Abraham, is there anything too hard for the Lord? God asks Jacob, what is your name? God asks Moses, what's in your hand? God asks Elijah, what are you doing here? God asks Amos, what do you see? God asks Malachi, the man around God? And God asks Ezekiel here in this passage, and he asks all of us, can these bones live? But I'm glad God doesn't stop. He waits for Ezekiel's answer. Easy optimism says yes. Shallow presumption says of course. Simplistic uncertainty says maybe. Giddy enthusiasm says I hope so. Negative pessimism says no way, Jose, possibly. Despairing doubt and despair depression says I don't think so. Apathetic despair says it's too helpless. Jaded cynicism says what difference would it make anyhow? And resignation says who cares? But a faith that rests securely in the way and will of a sovereign God says, oh Lord, God, thou knowest. I'm so glad God waits for this kind of faith to develop and mature in his children. For this faith sets us up with openness to God's will and God's way. But God didn't stop there at Ezekiel's answer either. Instead, God goes on to give him a peculiar set of instructions. In this powerful vision, God instructs him, speak to the Lord. Once again, I'm so glad that God didn't stop there. Well, if God had only stopped there, Ezekiel's talk to the bones might not be so clear. Who knows what Ezekiel might have said? He might have spoken his own words and not God's words. We might not have this dramatic story locked away in Ezekiel 37. But God tells him exactly how to address the bones when he speaks to the bones. The text bears witness that God says in verse 4, say unto the bones, O you dry bones. See, God says, Ezekiel, preface your speech by telling the bones of the truth. Don't you pretty it up and don't you soften its painful reality. Don't you dress it up or fix it up. Don't you sanitize it, politicize it, or euphemize it. Don't you add no spoonful of sugar to make the medicine go down. No, 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 no. God says, just tell it like it is. Call it like it is. The bones are dead and very, very dry. So say of the bones, oh, you dry bones. You see, that may sound politically incorrect, but that's God's speech. Before God can help and heal and make folks realize, God says you've got to face the facts and tell the truth about your situation. And so Ezekiel speaks to the bones and says, oh, you dry bones. Dry because the sky vultures sucked out all the marrows from your inside. Dry because the relentless desert sun bleached you over the many days. Dry because you lost all connection with organic humans of your body. Dry because you've been dead for a very long time. Dry because you've never been funeralized and buried. Ezekiel examined the bones bone by bone. He acknowledged and faced the facts. And that's what we've got to do right now. We've got to face the facts of our dry bone situations. We've got to confront the horrible realities of this troubled world. Yes, Meghan Markle might have married Prince Harry, but we still have a world of fear and poverty and war and mass shootings. So don't deal in shallow presumptions, easy optimisms and evasions. Don't try to confront people at funerals and tell them not to cry. You've got to cry sometimes when it's time to cry and pray when it's time to pray. We're not told in the Bible not to cry. We're told not to cry as those who have no hope. But you still got to cry sometimes. You still got to wring your hands and pinch the floor sometimes. You still got to say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. Shouldst thou withdraw thyself from me, whither shall I go? In our culture, most of us don't like to take sin very seriously. We don't see how sin deadens our nerves and dries up our bones. And so we hide our sins beneath deceptive euphemisms. We don't call a thief a thief, but we call him a kleptomaniac. We don't call a lie a bold-faced lie, but we call it a petty prevarication. We don't call failure failure, but we call it the mere achievement of an incomplete success. We don't call adultery adultery, but we call it keeping your options open. We don't call killing killing, but we call it national security. We don't call discrimination discrimination, we call it the elimination of the unqualified. We don't call shacking up, but we call it a period of pleasing, and feeding, testing the waters, trying on something, something. We don't call death death. We call it a mere transition or a metamorphosis. But I declare today it takes faith to face the facts and trust God in the valley of your dry bones. And if you tell the truth about your situation and face the facts about your issues, then God can set you up for breakthrough and victory. Faith has taught me that where there's a problem, there's a possibility. Faith has taught me that where there's an obstacle, there's an opportunity. Wherever there's a valley, there is a victory. Wherever there's a will, there's a way. Wherever there's sin, there's a savior. Wherever there's death, there's deliverance. Faith has taught me that God can do anything but fail. Faith has taught me that there's no problem that God cannot solve. There's no mess God can't fix. There's no prayer God can't answer. There's no sin God can't forgive. No barrier God can't break. No death God can't resuscitate. And no destruction God cannot reverse. By faith, prophet Ezekiel faced the facts and called it like it is. Address the bones and shake the bones, Ezekiel. Oh, you dry bones. But I'm so glad God didn't stop. God says, go beyond the talk of their condition and tell them of their recondition. God says, prophesy upon the bones. That means preach to the bones and say, hear the word of the Lord. I know you ain't got nothing but death, but preach to death. I know you ain't got nothing but bones, but just preach to the bones. You have no theological evidence. You may have no archaeological witness, but preach anyhow. Preach to the bones and say, oh, you dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And I challenge you this day to speak God's word over all your situations and preach to the bones, the circumstances and the issues you face in your life, and you'll find God has power to transform your situation. But I promise you, God and God's power doesn't stop there. God's power moves through the preached word and beyond the preached word. The text says they heard a mighty noise and the bones started coming together. The phalanges bones connected to the metatarsals, and the metatarsals connected to the tarsals, and the tarsals connected to the talus, and the talus connected to the tibia, and the tibia connected to the fibula, and the fibula connected to the patella, and the patella connected to the femur, and the femur connected to the coxal, and the coxal connected to the sacrum, and the sacrum connected to the vertebrae. But Ezekiel couldn't say all of that, so he just said the foot bone connected to the ankle bone, and the ankle bone connected to the shin bone, and the shin bone connected to the knee bone, and the knee bone connected to the leg bone, and the leg bone connected to the hip bone, and the hip bone connected to the backbone, and the backbone connected to the chest bone, and the chest bone connected to the arm bone, and the arm bone connected to the shoulder bone, and the shoulder bone connected to the neck bone, and the neck bone connected to the head bone. Bones come together with bones when the word of the God is preached. Oh, people of Vallejo Drive, God's word puts stuff back together. The Bible, God's written word, tells how Jesus, God's living word, carries a mighty power to put your bones, your dry bones situations back together. I just stopped by to tell somebody that when you declare God's word, your situation changes. Your dry bones start moving and reorganizing. But I want you to know, God doesn't stop there. Because the preached word brought the bones together, but they still stood up stuck and dead and lifeless and immobilized. Oh, I got to quit now, but God says, prophet Ezekiel, speak to the wind and say, oh breath, come upon these slain that they might live. So Ezekiel prophesied to the wind, and the spirit came, and the spirit gives life. I hear him saying in the words of this song, breathe on us, breath of God. Fill us with life anew, that we may love what thou dost love and do what thou wouldst do. And my brothers and my sisters, if we can pray this prayer and sing this song, we will get new life in all areas of our life. Jesus died to make this new life possible, and he promises the gift of the Holy Spirit to all who died with him, are buried with him, but are risen with him to live with him. And my dear Christian friends, I'm so glad that it doesn't stop there. This new life that God gives through God's Spirit lives on and on and on and on eternally and forever. Oh, if you want it, if you want that new life this day, I invite you to stand with me all over the building as we sing this song of consecration and commitment. Breathe on me, breath of God. Won't you stand and sing this song together? Fill me with life from you.